It would be a better place than looking around. believe it's about time to get started. Good to see everybody here today. Got a good number for Mother's Day. And happy Mother's Day to all the mothers. Amen. We'll be recognizing all the mothers here in just a little bit. But let's all stand together and sing a couple of songs today. You come lead us if you will.
It's a good one. It's called God is So Good on page 23. Everybody believes God's real good. Let's just say amen and amen. Amen, amen and amen.
Anybody with a special request today and for prayer? Okay.
Okay, Rosalind.
Frankie is an Alamance Regional, has been for the last week. Randy, they've changed his antibiotic medicine. He's had a lung infection. Seems to be doing some better.
Good.
Candy is on a new vitamin treatment. She keeps pneumonia and bronchitis, and they're trying to improve her immune system to help deter that. And my baby daughter is having troubles with her lungs. She seems to keep having pneumonia, bronchitis, infections of one sort. They've tried aspirators and things of that nature. It doesn't seem to be much improvement. So they've got her going to another specialist, so pray about that.
Okay.
Also, Autumn Lee has a review this week, so pray for her. She's pretty smart for her age.
Right.
She can hit you. She said some obnoxious. I don't know where she got the word, but
right.
She uses words sometimes that just really bore me.
Right.
But she's at a camp this week or today, and she'll be back late tonight.
Okay.
So we'll pray for her and pray for the mothers. You know, I've lost mine, and sometimes we don't realize. I know with your own mother, I miss her. She was a joy to me. We shared in a lot of things.
Yes.
I appreciate her, and I know Gary just lost his mother.
Yes.
So pray for all the mothers that are still alive.
Yes. Amen.
They'll continue to be so.
That's right.
Also pray for our church, Lord.
It's, amen.
Jesus is fixing to come back, and it won't be that long. The sermons I heard this morning, every one of them, including Peggy, which is unusual for him, is concerning the coming. He's going to come get us.
Right.
And then this world's really going to be left.
Yes.
All the signs are here.
Amen.
Pray for our church that we will continue to be a light to this neighborhood.
Amen. Sure will. Anyway. Okay, Carol.
A lady over around the Phyllis, I don't know, I can't remember her last name, but she's in the hospital. She's got cirrhosis of the liver, and they're waiting on a liver transplant, or they've got to take her to Charlotte.
Okay.
And then my niece up in West Virginia, over there, she's going to have open heart surgery in a couple of weeks.
All right.
So that's my oldest sister's daughter. And just pray for the rest of the Kiefers up there. My younger brother, Paul Edward, he gets a cold and ends up with pneumonia.
Anybody else? Yes.
Give me a prayer this week. I have a CT scan tomorrow for the lung cancer, and I will be going Thursday to see the doctor and find out the results of that. I ask that you pray for God's will in this matter, but hopefully His will is that we stay in remission.
Amen. Let's pray for Shirley. She gets a good report on this.
Yes.
That's for sure. He's done it before and he can do it again.
Amen.
Amen. That's right. Also, Kay Hilton came through surgery this week, did real well, and they think they've got all the cancer, so Kay is just tickled to death. So keep Kay Hilton in your prayer.
Yes.
Anybody else? Yes, Carol.
We have Kim Spanauer on there, and I heard from her this morning. She just finished a round of chemo, and she's going to be going back in June, I believe she said, for another round.
Okay.
And that, you know, they didn't get all that tumor out of her brain. They got what they
to see your children in that condition, I know. My wife wanted us sick today. She's got some kind of virus. We thought it was COVID, but it wasn't. It's Marvinitis. The only thing I can figure out, she's got Marvinitis. And,
are you sure of that?
I stay away from her for a while. She gets better. All right, but keep her in your prayers. She's not here today. All right. Yes, Will. All the way down to Florida, that's for sure. James?
Keep JC in your prayers. I haven't talked to him this week. Then you get out there, you know, you get so busy doing something else, you find out what he did. Also, Wayne and Ruby Kirk, he's in their 80s, but he failed in the bathroom and he's dead on the handrail. And he had a stroke here.
That one in our prayers, James.
She has Parkinson's.
Ruby. Okay. We'll keep Ruby in prayer for you. Okay. Yes.
This is Ruby, the R family, Trooper Olive from Ashburn.
Okay.
He got called to an accident on 64 last week and it was a fatality. The fatality was his mother.
It is. That's terrible. We'll keep him in our prayers.
Amen.
Keep that whole family in our prayers.
Yes,
for sure. All right. Yes, Linda.
I talked with my daughter yesterday and asked her about Maddie, and Maddie's going to be starting a stronger dosage of some kind of medicine. And the mother has asked that everybody just pray that she doesn't have any pain with this. She's a little weak, but she's not.
stand in an oak tree and see how powerful God is.
That's right. That little acorn turns into a giant oak tree.
That's right, man.
That's a pretty good analogy there, David. I appreciate you sharing that. Marie, it's good to see you back there in the back.
Amen.
Our prayers are with you. Good to see Joe there. And you're looking real good. Thank God for that. Pauline and Lewis Taylor, Captain Judy Lynch. How about Bobby? How's she doing, Jack?
Well, you're doing about the same, but I can see she slides down.
Still sliding some?
She just can't hardly remember a whole lot. That's the same thing over 2 or 3 times.
Okay. All right. Well, let's keep Bobby in our prayers. Good to see Helen back. Helen's been kind of sick. Well, I'm glad you're feeling better, Helen, and able to come today. Thank the Lord for that. Yeah. Okay. Somebody over here, Jared. Oh, Kate and Janice.
Just an update on Peyton Warren. Another one of Lexi's friends that had surgery this week.
Yes.
She came through it fine. I don't know what kind of PT, what kind of physical therapy they're doing, but she unwillingly went through physical therapy on Friday, but she did. But she was in a lot of pain.
Right.
Don't know how long she's going to be in the hospital, but the reduction surgery was successful as far as I know. I haven't heard anything since Friday. So.
Okay.
But, just keep her in prayer that she will, because she may have to have another surgery. I'm not real sure on that yet.
All
but
right.
She may have to have another.
Okay.
This condition that she's got.
We sure will, Janice. Keep her in our prayer. Okay, Linda, you want to give your list?
Yes. Went home yet.
Yes, you get a bird.
She said they, or the doctors are going to her to see, they want, she said this is routine and they do some chemo follow-up. But she's probably not going to do it, okay, for her own decision. And Boyd Johnson was in the ER this week with diverticulitis. They did send him home. Jim Agner is very weak and having trouble with mobility and there's no energy. And they're going through some more testing. He has glaucoma and floaters, which they'll follow up again in 6 to 12 weeks. Dolores has, Agner has bronchitis, that's getting kidney prayers. Larry Brown, that's Pete and Sylvia's boy. He was using a vape and it exploded. And he has also on oxygen, his oxygen tank caught on fire. And it burned his neck and his face, first and second degree burns. He was in Cone Hospital, but I heard they were thinking about sending him to bed. Pray for his wife, Lynette, and daughter, Lindsay.
Yes.
Kay Apple is doing better from her knee replacement surgery. See, she gave Diane Race home safely. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Judy Lynch, that she had shingles several years ago, and her trigeminal nerve in her face, down the side of her face, is giving her a lot of problems. She had an auto accident not too long ago. But anyway, pray for her and count is doing good. Thank you, Lord, for that.
Amen.
Ryan Kennis needs our prayers. I don't know how he was having some medical tests, but he needs our prayers for salvation. Carol Stevens is going to have plastic shoulder surgery, but that hasn't been set up yet. Teresa Mitchell, that's a preacher's sister. She's still in the hospital, but she is doing better. Ellen Ford's doing better. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Pray for our country leaders. We need it badly. Our first responders, all of the lost souls, all the sick and shut-ins. Lord, for your mercy and love and grace that you supply us.
Amen.
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 Larry Brown, as far as I know, they sent him home to let hospice take care of the burns at home because they didn't want to keep him in the hospital where he got likely get an infection or something.
Okay.
From what Gene had told me, that's his aunt.
Yeah.
That they had sent him home for hospice to take care of his first and second degree burns.
Okay.
I have one more that I can add today. Dan Ruth, RUPP, that's Joe's first wife's brother.
Yeah.
Okay. Elizabeth's brother. And he's had a heart bypass on Tuesday. He's a retired Baptist missionary and he lives in New Mexico. So please pray for Dan Root, R-U-P-P.
Dan Root, okay. We'll keep him in our prayers. Okay. How about unspokens today? Unspoken. Lord knows all the unspoken. Charles, will you lead us in prayer today?
Father, as I come to you this morning, we're grateful to be in the house of God on this beautiful day. And Lord, we just pray right now the sweet, sweet Spirit of God will take this service and do with it as you see fit.
Yes.
Lord, be in the pulpit and in the pews. Lord, convict those that are needing conviction. Lord, comfort those that are in need of comfort this morning. Our thoughts go out to all those that are here and all those names that have been called out. Father, what a list there is, but then what a God you are. You are
able.
We are trusting in you and we're asking for grace and mercy and the accepting of your will in our lives. Father, our prayers go out this morning, especially for the Gayton family, what it must be like to bury your mama on Mama's Day. So we just pray for that need and all those that are represented here this day, what their families and their heartbreaks and their heartaches. Lord, you're able to heal them all.
Yes.
Lord, we just ask now that you just continue in the service, be anything that be said or done after this. Lord, have your will and way, for it is in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Charles. We've got a couple of announcements here we want to mention. We recognize our mothers here in just a moment, but we have no service tonight. So if you're able to be with your mother, go see her today. Make sure all of you mothers get a carnation. There's enough for everyone to get one.
for all the mothers, and then we're going to see the baseball game over in High Point, the Hoppers. This is coming up May the 23rd,
Rockers.
Rockers? Okay, we'll make some ribs in there. Right. And that's going to be May the 23rd over at High Point, and then in June we're getting ready to go to Boone. So if you'd like to go to that one, I think there's a sign-up sheet. And then possibly in August we're going to take a trip, an overnight trip, at least one night, to see Moses up there at Lancaster, Pennsylvania. How many of you have ever seen that? Anybody here ever seen Moses or any of the productions? You know what I'm talking about? It's a long ways up there. Go ahead. Say it twice. They are wonderful.
Kevin back here went and saw Moses 2 weeks ago, and he said it was wonderful as well. And it will be two nights.
Two nights, okay, two nights for sure.
But we still got some money on.
Okay, still working on it, trying to get it down as cheap as we can for those that would like to go on that trip in August, okay? We'll give you some more details when we get a little closer. Let's go ahead and recognize all the mothers. If you're one of the mothers here with us today, and you've honored us with your presence, would you stand to your feet? I just want to give you a hand of applause. All the mothers, look at there. Isn't that wonderful? Thank you so much for what you do for us. Thank you so much for coming today. Let's start with the youngest mother. Youngest mother. Dad, can you come and help us? Well, we'll let them pick them out. Well, let's see here. They're pretty much the same.
I'll do anything you want me to do.
Okay, grab that one right there, and let's just see who the youngest one is. Any mother under 30? Any mother under 30? Any mother under 35?
Right. That's what we're bidding for right here.
Right over there she is. Man. Take it over there to her. Look at her. Yeah. All right. God bless you. How many children do you have here today? Four. That's wonderful. Give her a hand. How about the mother with who's the oldest mother, if you don't mind telling?
They won't
get
down.
Yeah, they get one too when we figure out who it's going to be here. How about all the mothers over 80? Raise your hand. Okay. Yeah, Martha in the back. How about over 90? Any mother over 90? How about 85? 85? One mother over 85. That's Marie. Okay. Give her a hand. Mother with the most children present. Anybody got more than four? I think she is a double winner today, Dad. No, right here. Right
there. Oh, she hit the check.
Okay. Now we have a real beautiful wreath that Irene made. And it says on there, welcome. She has made that for the mother who has been in the church the longest of any other mother. And if you're here in the church and you've been here, see this one right here, Dad.
Oh, yeah.
That wreath, isn't that pretty?
Well, I'm going to pick it up.
Well, you can leave it for whoever wins.
I can do it.
Can you do it?
Yeah, I got it.
Let's see it.
All right.
Isn't that pretty?
Everybody get a good view on it? How about you?
It's not for me. We haven't decided.
You got me running around.
I'm not doing anything. I'm just sitting here walking back up here.
I got to go back up here so I can see something.
I'm just sitting here watching and see what's happening.
You're running me to death.
Okay. How about the mother who's been here over 30 years? I figured it'd be Linda.
Yeah.
And Janice, where?
Linda's a founding member.
She's a founding member, so she's been here for the whole term.
I've been here 40 years and 9 months.
Wow. Blessing to us, Linda. Thank you, Irene, for doing that.
He didn't miss a summer before you did. I see the car hanging out of
there. Okay. Birthdays. We have Joshua Gate, Tommy Tennant, Alvin Bunton. Some of these may be out in the parking lot, but I don't see any of them in here. Anybody in here with a birthday coming up this week? How about anniversary?
I just want to say today is my grandson's birthday. The other one that was supposed to come, but he didn't show up with me this morning. He will be seven today. So just saying, today's his birthday.
Well, we'll keep giving our prayers, and we'll sing happy birthday to him when he comes back, okay? All right. Anniversaries? Anybody with anniversary coming up? Joe and Marie. All right. Let's give them a big hand there. Thank you, guys, and happy anniversary.
Thank you. Okay.
No, that's fine. That's fine. Yeah. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary. God bless you.
So much for everything you do for us. Thank you for being here today and going through these pews with these people. Lord, I just ask you to bless these children that are here today too.
Yes.
Because they're coming up in a world that's getting crueler by the day, Lord.
Yes, it is.
Lord, put the Holy Spirit in here and let him come and about the pews, Lord. Fill it with your blessing, Lord.
Amen.
Lord, thank you again for all that you do. We lift these prayer requests up to you. Know each need, Lord. Let us also be good stewards with this offering we receive and do everything in praise, honor, and glory of your name. I also ask that if there's one here today that doesn't know you as their personal Savior, I hope today will be the day they come forth, Lord. Now go with us and lead God and direct us in all things. We give to you. Amen.
Amen.
Knows this. Amazing grace.
sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
All together, relax.
When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we know less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
Songs on my heart so much, but this morning, but it is. They say that the nearest thing to God's love is the love of a mother. Mama's love, even when they don't get love back. They forgive when they really shouldn't, even when it's hard. So I understand and I take. I agree with the fact that the mother's love is something special. I wish that we as a church and Christians could get just a little taste of that when it comes to having compassion. When you come running hurt to mama, she don't ask you how much or how you got hurt. She just fixes what's wrong. Love of God.
Amen.
The song looks at mama's love from maybe a little different angle. And I don't know if I'll sing it to all this morning or not, but we'll give it a try.
Amen. Bless
you. Only a tramp was Lazarus. He was laid down at the rich man's gate to beg for the crumbs from the rich man to eat. He was only a tramp and on the
some other.
darling to see, but they left him to die like the tramp on the street. Yes, they left him to die.
Went through all of that for all of us. Amen. And suffered more than anyone's ever suffered. Thank God for that beautiful song. I could take your Bible, turn to Proverbs. In Proverbs chapter number 31, we're looking today at the mother of all mothers. And this has the ideal mother in it. And it also applies to the men as well. Applies to all of us, the ideal mother. We find that this lady is very virtuous, she's very godly, she loves her family, she protects her husband. But the most important thing you find about her, she loves the Lord. And so we find this in Proverbs chapter 31, starting in verse number 10, reading down through the next few verses. Who can find a virtuous woman? Her price is far above rubies. The heart of her husband does safely trust in her, so that he shall have no need of spoil. She shall do him good and not evil all the days of her life. She seeketh wool and flax and worketh willingly with her hands. She's like the merchant ships. She bringeth forth food from afar. She riseth also while it is yet night and giveth meat to her household and a portion to her maidens. She considers a field, she buys it. With the fruit of her hands, she planteth the vineyard. She girdeth her loins with strength and strengthen her arms. She perceiveth that her merchandise is good. Her candle goeth out not by night. She layeth her hands on the spindle and her hands hold the distaff. She stretcheth out her hand to the poor, yea, she reacheth forth her hands to the needy. Isn't that like a lot of mothers?
Amen.
You know, you've known mothers that was everybody's mother. Yeah. And they're in the neighborhood when you're growing up. You may not even be related to them, but yet they take you in like your own son, like they're your own, you're their son. And so that's what she's talking about. She stretches out her hands to the poor. She reaches forth her hands to the needy. She's not afraid of the snow for her household, for all of her household, they're clothed with scarlet. She maketh herself coverings of tapestry. Her covering is silk and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sitteth among the elders of the land. She maketh fine linen and selleth it and delivereth girdles unto the merchants. Strength and honor are her clothing. She shall rejoice in time to come. She openeth her mouth with wisdom and her tongue with the law of kindness. She looketh well to the ways of her household and eateth not the bread of idleness. Her children arise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praiseth her. Many mothers, or many daughters, have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. Favor is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a mother who fears the Lord, she shall be praised.
Yes.
Give her the fruit of her hands and let her own works praise her in the gates. So let's go to the Lord in prayer before message. The Blessed Mother. Father, we come today and ask your blessings upon us. We take this time to look at this mother. Help us, Lord, to all try to implement the many principles that we see in this passage of this wonderful lady who sets a great example of what a mother is. Thank you for all the mothers here today. Those who are in heaven, tell them we love them. Tell them we said hello and we'll see them again. And Father, we just pray that for every person here today, it would be an uplifting message, that it would help us to keep our focus on heaven. And Lord, on you and what you do with us while we're walking on this earth to get to heaven. And we'll thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yes, amen.
Anna M. Jarvis first suggested the National Observance
of a Mother's Day way back May the 10th, 1908, at a memorial service for her mother. And she decided it'd be good to have that for all mothers. So it's been over 100 years now. Her mother's favorite flower was the carnation, and they gave all the mothers a carnation that attended the service. And within the next few years, the idea to honor mothers had gained such popularity, it was celebrated in the large cities of the United States. So on May the 9th, 1914, it's a little over 6 years away, by an act of Congress, President Woodrow Wilson proclaimed the second Sunday in May as Mother's Day. He established the day as a time for public expression to love and reverence our mothers for the country. And then it became customary to wear white carnations for departed mothers and red for the living. Now, it is certain that mothers need to be honored. Thank God for mothers. They enter the jaws of death to bring us into life. Yes. And they need to be honored. I heard about a little boy, and he was in a Sunday school presentation. His mother was on the front row, and he had forgotten his lines in a play they were doing in the Sunday school class. And the mother was on the front line trying to prompt him. She gestured, formed words silently with her lips, but that didn't help. Her son's memory went blank. He didn't know what to say. So finally she leaned forward and she whispered, "I am the light of the world." That's what he's supposed to say. Then he beamed and smiled with a great feeling in his voice, and he said, "My mother is the light of the world." Amen. My mother is the light of the world. And I think we could all agree with that little boy. Maybe your mother's already gone to heaven. Well, for some here today, this may be your first Mother's Day without your mother. And my heart goes out to you today. Be encouraged. Don't be discouraged. Because she is in a better place. She's glad. She's happy. She's not hurting. She's united with the ones that's gone on before her. And all the saints of God. And they are worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ. And so thank God for mothers who love God and who have already preceded us to heaven, and we will meet them there one day.
Yes.
And so, the hand that rocked the cradle rules the world, somebody said. This is your day, mothers. We honor you. I thank God for my mother. She taught me about God. Dad did too, all of my life. They carried me to church 9 months before I was ever born. Amen. I was mischievous, but she never gave up on me. She prayed for me. She stood up for right and against that which was wrong. I remember I had a paper route. There was two bullies in the neighborhood, and they'd always pick on me. And I told her about it, and she went down there and got on those boys. And boy, I'm telling you, she jumped on them like ugly on an ape. And I thought she was going to kill them both. I said, "Mom, just that's enough." They never did bother me again. Amen. Thank God for mothers that look after their children. Thank God for my wife. She's a great mother to our daughter, Karen. She's always stood for the Lord, that which is right, and against that which is wrong. She's led our daughter to follow in the footsteps of Jesus Christ and been a tremendous blessing to me. I could never have made it in the ministry without her. This morning, we look at the mother of Proverbs 31. She's an example of what we need to be doing for the Lord, whether we're a mother or not, because she has a strong faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Some people have the idea, the ideal mother in the Bible is just very quiet, entirely domestic, very retiring, out of the limelight. But let me say this, a mother and a wife is a manufacturer, she is an importer, she is a manager, she is a realtor, she is a farmer, she is a seamstress, she is an upholteress, she is a merchant. Her strength and her dignity do not come from her amazing achievements. They come because she realizes that Jesus Christ is her beauty.
Yes.
Now, beauty goes skin deep.
Yes.
And we know that with age, sometimes beauty fades. But, thank God, a mother who loves Jesus Christ is a beautiful lady.
Amen.
And she loves the Lord. Number one, the blessed mother protects her husband. That you find in verse number 10. Who can find a virtuous woman? Her price is far above rubies. This is a virtuous woman. What does that word virtuous mean? Carries the idea of a band of soldiers. She's a strong army, protecting and defending her husband against the attacks that Satan's throwing against him. And she encourages her children to walk with God and look to God for their help. And so she is very valuable, like a treasure chest of rubies, the Bible says there. And so when you think about this mother, we know that her husband doth safely trust in her, and she will do him good in verse number 12, and not evil all the days of her life. So the heart of the husband safely trusts in her. He doesn't have to be jealous over his wife because he knows that she is looking after his welfare. He knows that she is doing the Lord's work, and she will do him good in verse number 12 and not evil all the days of her life. See, that blessed mother works hard to help the father and the children, pushing them towards the Lord. Whether young, middle-aged, senior years, the blessed mother loves her husband in all seasons of life. This kind of a woman is an asset, and good comes to him can be directly attributed to her, as she has given him many benefits of life. She supports her husband. She encourages him. She is faithful to help him all of her life. I heard about one woman, and this woman, she woke up and her husband was getting ready to leave for work. She said, "Honey," with a big smile on her face, "I bet you don't know what day this is, but this is the best day of our life." And you know how husbands are. He couldn't figure it out. Is it her birthday? Is it her anniversary? So he got ready for work, and he said, "It sure is. This is a great day, honey. How could I ever forget? This is a wonderful day." He went out the door trying to remember what day it was. He tried all day long to remember what day it was. And anniversary? No. Birthday? No. The day kept getting closer to the time to get off. Finally, he went home and he had a plan to save himself. And he rushed into the house. He said, "Honey, I want you to get your best dress. You got, put it on. We're going out and paint the town tonight. We're going to celebrate this outstanding day in our life." Woo! He was really getting with it. She was getting happy. So she was getting ready, and he rushed down to the florist, bought her a lovely bouquet of flowers, took her to the most expensive restaurant, spent over $200 just to celebrate the day, not even knowing what he was celebrating. And then on the way home, he finally discovered what day it was. His wife snuggled up close to him, placed her arm around his shoulder, planted a soft kiss on his cheek, and said, "Honey, this is the best Groundhog Day I've ever had." The best Groundhog Day I've ever had. Well, the Blessed Mother looks after the husband. Number two, the Blessed Mother is a diligent worker. See that in verse number 13. She seeketh wool and flax, working willingly with her hands. Flax was grown for its seed and fiber. It could be used to make clothing, belts, lamp wicks. Flax was a plant with blue flowers, small round fruits. The wool, of course, came from the sheep. So the Blessed Mother knows her job is never finished. Her job is more valuable than rubies, the Bible said. Look at verse 14. She's like the merchant ships. She brings her food from afar. I mean, she is working hard to get whatever her family needs to take care of her family. Verse 15, she riseth also while it is yet night and giveth meat to her household and a portion to her maidens. Again, this stresses that mother who sacrifices to the point she burns the candle at both ends to look after her family and her husband. A mother, somebody gave me this and I thought it was pretty good. A mother is a maker, a mender, a moderator, and a teacher. She makes boxers' pants, chocolate pudding, law, and sometimes order, castles, threats, promises, and rabbit suits. She makes horses' heads from paper bags, little suits from big ones, new dresses from old ones, sun suits from kitchen curtains, small balloons from pot balloons, stew from nothing whatsoever. She maketh peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, and more peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. Amen. A mother is a maker and a mender. She mends broken dishes, broken trousers, broken hearts. She mends hurt noses and hurt feelings and trouser knees and jackets, torn fingers and trousers knees. She mends old sheets and old rose bushes and old bob dolls and trousers knees. Amen. A mother's a maker, a mender, and a moderator. She's a moderator in times of war. Sometimes a civil war breaks out in the house. It could be a verbal war. It could be an insurrection, a minor skirmish, attacks from the enemy in times of strife and injustice, in times of temper, in times of pulling the hair out. A mother's a maker, a mender, a moderator, and a teacher. She teaches how to button buttons and how to say a prayer. She teaches how to hold a knife and a fork, how to hang the clothes up, and sometimes stay hung in the closet, and how to sit still in church. I heard about two boys, and they was sitting there, and they were talking in church, and Mom said, "Shh, be quiet. Those men back there will get you." And one of them looked at the mother and said, "What's those two men sitting at the back for?" She said, "They're the hushers." I think she meant to say ushers, and she said, "They're the hushers." They will usher you out if you give too much problem, huh? See, mother also reaches despair at times. You ever been there, mother? Sometimes it gets rough. The dryer won't dry when all the clothes are washed and wet. The baby bites the cat's tail and scratches. 3-year-old dumps the tinker toys in the front door when you expect the preacher to call. The baby screams for attention. Soothing medications are halted. Mother sprints to a relentless doorbell. There stands two neighborhood children reporting your baby's out here in the front yard crying. And so she goes out there and finds the 2-year-old sitting there crying. And the 8-year-old dashes in and says, "Forget it, I'll take her some cookies." Fingerprints are all over the house. The ragged edge of the rug seems dreadful. The 3-year-old won't go outside. The cat won't come in. The gelatin won't gel. The sun won't shine. The stew sticks are stew sticks and it's boiling over in the pot. And while it all is happening, the kids are saying, "Mama, come and see this. Mama, come and see that." And she can't get a moment's rest. Mothers lean their chin on the broom. And she says, "Next time, Lord, I think I'll just raise chickens." And then about that time, the 10-year-old crashes in, rough and ready, all boy. He confides in Mom and he says, "Mom, at the Cub Scout meeting today, we had to list 5 things that are the most precious to us. And I did. Number 1 is God. Number 2 is mother and father. Number 3 is America. Number 4 is babies. Number 5 is sunsets." Suddenly, the baby's eyes seemed very blue. The 6-year-old recited from memory the entire 23rd Psalm, which is better than spelling what. Fingerprints retreat again. Daddy walked in. Really, life cannot be much richer. It is a glory never to be bartered. Finally, she says, "Dear Lord, you keep the chickens. I'll carry on for now." Out of my heart, amen. That's a mother. A mother is there to help you. The blessed mother is a compassionate friend. Look down at verse number 20. She stretches out her hand to the poor. She reaches forth her hands to the needy. She's there not only for her family, but for every other child in the neighborhood. Then number 4, the blessed mother is a family provider in verse number 21. She's not afraid of the snow for her household, for all of her household are clothed in scarlet. Snow represents the coldness. She has plenty of warm clothes that she has spun and made. Verse 23, her husband is known in the gate when he sitteth among the elders of the land. That was where the business was conducted, at the gate of the city. And everybody knew who the husband was because of the way that she worked in her fields of growing different products. Verse number 24, she makes fine linen. She sells it. She delivers girdles unto the merchant. Verse 25, strength and honor are her clothing. She shall rejoice in time to come. Verse 26, she openeth her mouth with wisdom, and in the tongue the law of kindness. Words of wisdom are in her vocabulary. Mother knows how to make a sore quit hurting by just a little kiss on that sore. I know my mother, she used to come in, and when I'd have a scratch, or I'd have a bruise, or I'd have a cut, she'd put alcohol on it, and man, it burning worse than the bruise did, or the scratch did, or the wound did, and then finally she'd reach down there and start kissing and blowing on it.
made it feel better. But you know what was better than that? When she came home with peroxide, amen. She put that peroxide on that wound, and I mean, it looked like lemon meringue pie on the top of my head. But it didn't hurt, and it didn't burn, and I said, thank God for the peroxide. Get another bottle of that, Mama. Verse 27, she looketh well to the ways of her household, eateth not the bread of idleness. Her children arise up and call her blessed. Her husband also, and he praiseth her. Many daughters are done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. Then in verse number 30, we see the fifth thing about her. The blessed mother has a strong faith in God.
Right.
Here's what it says. Favor is deceitful, beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord, she shall be praised. Her secret is her godly character. Verse number 31, give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. God will bless her with diligence, hard work. He has many rewards for her, and he has many blessings. The Statue of Liberty in New York Harbor was sculptured by the famous sculptor Barthotti, and he gave 20 years of his life to that work, and he pledged his own private fortune to defray the expenses to get it completed. When it came time to look for a model to see who was going to reproduce Lady Liberty, he chose his own mother. Isn't that great? When you see that Statue of Liberty, you know it's the sculptor's mother who's standing up there. Kathy Ridley was a member of the U.S. women's gymnastic team, 1972 Olympics at Munich. She only had one goal in mind, to win the gold medal. She had trained hard over a long period of time. On the day that she was scheduled to perform, she couldn't get her strength and control the way it needed to be. She was tense. For some reason, she performed pretty well, but when it was all over, her name was not even mentioned in the top three. She was crushed. Afterwards, she went up in the stands, joined her parents, and she sat there and she cried and she cried and she cried. And she said, Mama, I'm sorry, but I did my best. You know that. And she said, I know that, Mother said. And I'm sure God knows that too. Then Kathy recalls her mother said 10 words that she never forgot. Doing your best is more important than being the best. Let us all do our best for Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Let's bow our heads in prayer while heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Maybe you're here today and you've never been saved. Today's the day of salvation. If you'd like to know the Lord today, you can. In your heart, would you pray something like this? Dear Jesus, I receive you as my Savior. Forgive me of my sin. Save my soul. Make me a home in heaven. In Jesus' name. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. If you invited Christ to be your Savior, I just want to say you made the best decision you could ever make. I just want to pray for you. Anyone like that, if you ask Christ to be your Savior, would you just look up, and I'll know by you looking up you made that decision. I'll pray for you today.
Yes.
God bless you. Thank you for that.
Yes.
Amen. Maybe today you'd say, I know the Lord, and I'm so glad I'm saved. The Lord's been so good to me. I need His strength. I need His help. Just be my prayer partner. Pray with me about a burden on my heart, preacher. I'll be glad to remember you in a special prayer. Anyone like that, you'd slip a hand up. All around the building, hands are lifted everywhere. Father, we come to you today, and we ask that you'll bless each one here. Those that looked up for salvation, let them know they made the best decision. Lord, use them as wonderful Christians for you, Lord, in your kingdom. Bless everyone here today. Those that had a hand lifted, whatever the burden is, I know you can meet it according to your holy, precious will. Bless every mother, those who are here with us, those who have gone on to heaven. And Father, we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's stand on our feet while heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Charles, play softly. If you want to come around the altar this morning and pray, you feel free to come. Maybe you want to come and thank God for your mother. Maybe you want to come and just thank God for what mother's instilled in you. Maybe you as a mother want to pray for your family. Pray for the children. Pray for the grandchildren. Whatever the need is. Maybe you just got a heavy burden on your heart. Come down and just lay it at the foot of the cross. Oh, when you do that, you're going to get help. You're going to get strength. Anybody else want to come?
Maybe you want to come and be saved this morning. If you've been saved, you want to come and make that public, we'll be glad to announce that good news, what's happened in your life. You come. Maybe you want to come and join. We'd love to have you here at Grace Baptist, one loving church. You come. Whatever God leads you to do. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Christians are praying. Lord, I'm coming home.
Seated just for a moment. Thank you, child. Virginia, if you'll come up here, this is Virginia Dawson. She has really been a blessing to us. We appreciate her. We love you, Virginia. We're praying with you. God bless you. She's coming today to join here at Grace Baptist Church.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Bless me. All those in favor, let's give the Lord a big amen. Ready?
Amen.
Thank God. Come by and shake her hand. Let her know you appreciate her coming and joining here at the church.
Yes.
And you are a blessing to us, Virginia, and I pray for you and all your family. Thank you for joining us.
I would like to say, I want to thank everyone who's been so friendly to me. And I feel like God has brought me to this church because it's a home church. It's an old fashioned church.
Amen.
It's how long I've been looking for one. And I'm blessed for them. I know it is.
Amen. Thank God.
Yes. And I'll just pray for me and always do God's will.
You're a blessing to us, Virginia. Let's give her a hand. All right, let's stand and we'll be dismissed in prayer. And I'll ask at this time, Joe in the back. Joe, would you dismiss us after he does? Come by. All the ladies, make sure you pick your carnations up before you leave. Right on the front. And then come by and shake Virginia's hand on the way out. Everybody come by and shake her hand. Let her know you appreciate her being a part of the team here at Grace Bay. Brother Jeff.
Our kind and gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for this special day. Honor our mother. Thank you for your blessings and every mother. Thank you for lifting up and encouraging. Help them to encourage and take care of everyone. Help us all to do our best to serve. Thank you for all our sins.
All the ladies, come up and get your flowers. God bless you.
Been doing?
I'm doing fine. How about you?
I know she's been moving around really good.
Yeah, well,
that's and you've always got that good spirit. I just love that about you.
Thank you.
I'll do it.
sure was a good service.
Yep, it was.
Someone holding will work the food sign.
All the
time. Every day.
Well, I tell you what, just about every day when we get out.
Each time we go out in the car, you pass somebody.
Yeah. It just depends on where you go. The closer you get to larger cities, the more people you will see. I don't really understand why that is, but that's the way it is. When I used to drive a truck, all the time, I had people coming up to me looking for money, looking for something. Your truck drivers are rich, so we got hit. We got hit every place from my truck shops, whatever. It's something you need to think about, though, because some of them really do need to help. Some of them really need to be assisted. Before we get any further, let's go to prayer. Lord God in heaven, I thank you, Father, for this opportunity, Lord, to bring an important message, Father, an important story. And I pray, Lord God, that you just might encourage and strengthen today, Lord, as we look at the real issues of the world. Father, they're all around us. They're real. They're honest. There are some people, Lord, that we know really don't need it, but for one reason or another, they're out there. So there's chances they really do need it. Father, I pray that you just bring encouragement, strength, another, that's another thing. I used to get a lot of people on the truck that would come up and want to wash my window, clean out the truck. Fellas would carry out and carry a box, I carry a flatbed, but they wanted to wash out the box, and they'd probably do it for $20. Or if you went to the cleaner, we'll wash it out, it'd be $50. So you can actually get it done cheaper, but they didn't do half a bad job. But it was the law that had to be washed out every time before it gets reloaded.
But you see more of the bears out there on the intersection than you do if somebody's going to work. I didn't see that yet. But you have.
There's some. There really are.
Yeah. Well, it seems like the ones that say will work for food are the ones that really need it.
Yeah. Chances are.
That I would believe. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I look at their clothing. Mm-hmm. I look at their shoes and their clothing. Because there's a lot of people that have little workable food that don't need it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because if you have dryer creases in your clothes, mm-hmm. and your clothes are clean, and you have a haircut, and you're fresh and safe, you're not a monster.
Probably not, but then again, I know me, that's all I can say. If my family went down, I didn't have the money to feed my family, I'd be out there too, and I would probably dress up as best I could. Someone holding this kind of a sign make you feel? We've had some comment on that already. How do you usually respond when seeing a person with a sign like this? So many different things, so many different needs. You talk about somebody that's out there, but you really don't think they need to be there. They either look good, they dress good, that kind of thing. But what I was saying is, if it was me, I would do that, but I don't know how low I would have to get before I would stand out there begging. I've never done it. We've been in some tigers and drinks, but I never saw myself reach down far enough to beg. I just can't do it, just not me. But some of these people, if they're out there, there's a good possibility they're not doing very well. They may not need a lot of help, but they may not have things that they would like to have for their children or for the wives. So it's hard to say. It's a hard call.
Well, I think the Lord will lead you too. There's times the Lord leads me. I see somebody and he puts that impression upon me that I need to get me some food. Now, very seldom does he put the pressure on me that I need to give him money. Yeah. But when he does, I'll give him money.
It's usually best if there's too many of them out there that are out there with the money for growth.
Especially with the little kids standing there.
Yeah.
Really good.
One member of a mission team on a trip to a remote country was in a wheelchair. The country's main airport was an obstacle course for that teammate. Finally, the team located someone that could unlock the door, but who seemed to have the attitude that people in wheelchairs should not travel. That opinion should have never come out. In Jesus' day, many believed suffering was punishment for sin. People with disabilities were treated accordingly. We're going to find out the story today. That's not always true. Acts 2:42-47 summarizes the ongoing activities of the early church in Jerusalem, including miraculous displays after the day of Pentecost. Miracles brought compassionate relief to the afflicted, but their primary purpose was to validate the truth for Christianity in person and work of Jesus. The settings, the afternoon prayers, daily station. Okay, we'll stop there. The setting, now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour, and a certain man laying from his mother's womb was carried. Whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. All believers at this time were Jewish. There were no Gentile Christians at this time, not until after Acts 10, which Peter preached, and there were everybody in the place received. Time, all could be saved just for the answer. Okay? That was a turning point right there when Peter preached. Prayer was done at least three times a day when they preached in there. So they were coming to the temple three times a day, once in the morning, once in the afternoon, just called the ninth hour, which in our time would be around 3 o'clock, and one in the evening. Three times a day, they had something to preach, to pray about. And a lot of times, those preachers going out at the same time. Anybody back in those days would stand up. Anybody wanted to could stand up and preach the message. When the apostles came in, everybody knew who they were. Peter and John were walking together here. Fell at the gate, and the gate was wide enough where there was a large bunch of people coming in. So he's down there, and he's asking for alms. Back in those days, probably all he had to do was hold his hand out to exactly what he needed. Now, he'd been there a long time. Okay, this is a man, not a boy. A man is there that could not get up to his legs, asking for alms. Alms just being a gift from someone of heavenly value. Okay. Some money, sometimes this is what we need, this is what we're going to try to get for that person. Okay. So it's not just looking for money. What adjustments can your congregation make to ensure that people with disabilities can easily participate in worship in your meeting place?
Have an accessible table. We're very accessible.
That's a nice part. We don't have any long steps. You have to come up, come right there, walk the floor level. Well, somebody in a wheelchair. And the doors, the double doors here, you know, so it's wide enough. You know, almost any wheelchair can come in here. Now, also, the way you set up churches, most churches are set up that this has got a fire dial in the middle. That's so people can walk up and down the aisle without being crowded. People will not be crowded in a church. They will not be crowded in a church. If they go to a big church, say Pleasant Garden Baptist Church over there, when we were going over there, you had to try to find a seat. And it was difficult getting in for anybody with disabilities, especially a wheelchair. So they had ushers helping those people out to get in where they want to go. This is plenty big. We can walk a wheelchair. As a matter of fact, it's been that way. You can park a wheelchair on one side, and people can still come down this aisleway. So it's accessible. It's accessible. There's no reason for anybody not to come that has any kind of issues. That's what they're talking about here. should be recruited to help a program follow through? Probably anybody that's willing to help. I mean, somebody comes up to that door and doesn't have anybody to help them get in, there's going to be some people who will jump up and go help them. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just a kind of level of truth that we have. The expectations, the innocent grasp. Who's seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple? This man asked the alms of Peter and John. Again, I said that alms was something that had a meaning to it. It wasn't just money. Sometimes coins and that kind of thing that they hand to them, but not always. Peter, fastening his eyes upon him, said, "With John, look on us." He gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something from them. Like I said, there was a wide gate. A great gate, beautiful, was a wide gate to let people coming through there. So this man sitting there, asking alms, he's trying to catch the eyes of everybody coming in. You know, just in case they look, he could stay rattled and hold his hand out. And because of that, he's not going to be looking at one person at any particular long amount of time. Okay, he's going to be out there looking for everybody, you know, trying to get home. So when they came in, when Peter and John came in, I'm not getting ahead of myself too much here. They came up to him, and Peter said, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, "Look on us." And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. When he said, when Peter said, "Look on us," he said, it was an attention here. Okay? He's looking at everybody else. Look on us. So he looked at them, and that's when Peter went on to say, that I don't have much to give you, which we'll get into that in a second, but I still want to help. And when he says, "Look on us," he's saying, "I got something for you. Look at us." Okay. The innocent were asking, undivided attention, and forthright admission. So the expectations we're going to be looking at here. How can you practice being more attentive to people you might be tempted to ignore? When you go into a large city, and it's getting that way in Greensboro, there's so many people on so many different corners, gas stations, stores. I know some of the stores try to control it. They've even had some that told them you can come in here and you can do your thing, but you have to have you have to be registered with the store. Okay, just to let them know, you can come in here, we want you to want to help you out how we can, but you can't come in here doing random things. And we don't want to hear about anything they even stole out of the cars. So that was the kind of things we had to watch for at that time. What kinds of people, if any, should believers not associate with? What scripture supports your answer? Is there any kind of people we shouldn't associate with as Christians?
I believe so.
Who?
Because they'll lead you. So somebody should, that you know to, you know, make you not live on to do the right thing or something like that. And when you really know it.
Places in the Bible that talks about it.
Well, my mom told me not to mess around with people, get you in trouble.
this is what they really meant. They did mean that when they were preaching. This is what they really meant, that kind of thing. Okay? Judaizers would go around and try to tell people, this is what's really going on, and it usually ended up being, that means you have to give money to us to keep us going.
Yeah. I think the one scripture that comes to my mind, Randy, is over Psalm 101. Mm-hmm. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, or standeth in the way of sinners, or sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord.
Yeah, there, right there. Yeah. Perfect.
That's what my mama told me not to associate with certain people. Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
So they can sway you, make it like it just pure and everything, but then they get you in trouble. And then blame it on you.
Make sure
that's a good one.
The only other place in scripture I can think of, I couldn't find it, but I was looking for it, was when Jesus said to the apostles, when you go into a place and they receive you not, knock the dust off your feet while you're leaving. Okay. Sorry, I don't know exactly where it is, but it's another message that is in the Bible.
I know, you know, if you play with the wrong bunch, you're going to get hurt.
Yep. I'm getting ahead of myself here, so let me catch up here just a little bit. Then Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. When he said, look on us, when Peter said, look on us, he's holding his hand out for alms. Peter said, I don't have any gold or silver. So it could be coins, could be trinkets, whatever it might be that were the value that they could give them. Okay? They didn't get that. Peter said, such as I have, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Now, back in those days, as well as today, I've heard of a lot of fellows that have the name Jesus, Jose, and different names like that, that are very close, or they mean, in their own language, Jesus. Okay? Had a different pronunciation. What's going on is, back in that day, there was the name Jesus was a popular name. So Peter said, he didn't just say the name of Jesus, or with the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit was going to do it. But in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, everybody knew who that was. Everybody knew about Nazareth because of Jesus. Jesus put Nazareth on the map. But because of Jesus of Nazareth, stand up and walk. In what ways does Peter's response set precedent for believers? Or in what ways was it not? When he said that, he didn't have any money. Okay? I got to wonder about that when I'm asked this question. What would it be like if we got up to a street corner, rolled down the window, and talked to somebody, you know, that had a sign out, or work for money, or whatever it might be, you know, need money, sick, that wife sick, kid sick, something like that, whatever it might be, if you roll the window down and ask them, is this really what you want? Do you want money, or can I help your family? Okay. Jesus could have given them money, which obviously, because he's been there for such a long time, he never could walk. He's always been there asking for alms, so he's got enough to live on. That's it. Enough to probably have one suit of clothes, and that was it. But he gave money for food and such. Okay. Same thing out here. When they're holding up a sign, they need particular things, obviously. Now, I know the skeptics are going to say, yep, he's staying out there, doesn't need anything, but he wants money for drugs, wants money for beer, wants money for whatever. May be that way, may not. But that's something we'll probably never know. We'll probably never know, unfortunately. So when Peter told him, in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, rise up and walk, that was a gift. That was a big, big gift that he could give this fellow. How can you practice meeting a person's physical needs while also not ignoring his or her spiritual needs? In other words, if you did give him money, what is it going to do? You have to stay there. Some people will not do anything in their own time of trouble. Some people will always look for somebody else. Money, job, anything like that. Can't do it on their own for whatever reason. Okay. When you go out and you have a conversation with somebody, whoever that might be, if it's in a situation like this, or if somebody you're just talking to running up and down the escalator in the store, is it wrong for us to tell them about Jesus?
No.
God bless you.
Okay.
Sometimes
when I give somebody a bag of food, I'll have some of the Bible tracts back here, and I'm
sticking
down in the back,
goes
back up
there. Excellent. Excellent choice.
Because you don't ever know when that one
them just as much as he loves the rest of us, and he sent me to help meet your physical need.
There you go. And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. And he leaping up and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. Peter reached down and held his hand out, took his hand, and stood him up by the right hand. Okay, which back in those days, the right hand is always the hand of fellowship. The left hand is the hand of rejection. It's just the way it works. Back then and today, it's the same thing. You tell your left hand, so I don't know what left handers do. Maybe they just shift with their right hand. But anyway, what happens is he reached out, took him by the hand, they told him to stand up. And that's when Peter reached down and helped him walk. Now you got to remember something. This fellow from birth has never walked. Okay? Now when you think about it, his ankle bones were weak. He had no knee bones, cartilage, muscle, hip bones, anything like that that we use to walk. Now, when you get up and you walk, your mind's got to tell you, put this foot in front of this one. It's a process that your mind goes through. He's never done any of that. Nothing like that. He had no idea what it's like to walk. He sees people walking, but he has never been able to do it. Peter picked him up. He picked him up, just put his hand out and helped him stand up. And at that time, at that very instant, he stood him up, his feet, ankle bones, knee bones, hips, muscle structure, all that became prevalent to this man to the point where he could use it not only to stand up. He leapt up. So he believed in the word of God, believed in Peter of God. He knew that it was going to happen because Peter said it was going to happen. And it was a total miracle that that happened. Absolutely a miracle. Now, he stood up, leaped up, walked, and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. There's one other time this happened in Acts was in Acts 12, Acts 10, I think it was, where there were 10 men that came to Jesus. And Jesus healed each and every one of them with their infirmity. They walked to the town. Jesus told them, go and tell priests what has happened to you. They started walking towards town. One of them stopped, turned around, and came back to Jesus. The rest of the nine of them kept going into town. Turned around, came back to Jesus, and thanked God for what happened. Because he knew that's where it came from. Okay? He knew that's what happened. And Jesus asked them, yes, praise God, because God is the one that did this miracle. But what Jesus was wondering, what about the other nine? Were there not ten? And he told, blessed are thou, because of what you have done. So, he's going, he didn't go home. He didn't go to his family. He tells family and rejoice with his family. You know about this miracle that just had happened. There was something. He went in with Peter and John into the sepulcher. Now when he went in there, everybody knew him. Everybody knew this man. He's been sitting there for so long, asking alms three times a day. I don't know if he got there three times a day or not, but he was there all the time, every day, anyway. And they went by there, and they came by there all the time. And a lot of the people that were going in there were Jews. And Jews back in those times were known to have money. So he went in, praise God, in the sepulcher with Peter and John so that everybody could see them. Okay. And it went out from there. How can you give praise to God through expressions of worship that are different from your normal expression? People see you all the time. All the time. A Christian is always, always being checked out, put it that way.
You can tell it's something different.
Yeah. Something different.
Yeah, sometimes you got the right hand going, you got to do something going on, and touches the spirit, all those feel you, you wouldn't have to raise it.
There you go. There you go.
Saying the blessing before you eat in a public place.
That's another one, very well, Pastor.
And you know, it's good for your grandchildren to see you do that. Both of those things. Mm-hmm. Because that's how they want. They want us all alive.
Grandparents, mom, dad, brothers, sisters, they all have something. I don't mind it. How will you use your unique skills and talents? Praise God in this regard. Do we all have a calling?
Yeah, I believe we do.
Everybody has a calling. So there's something that we can do. A godly thing we can do that the Holy Spirit is going to be standing behind us.
Can you give it to
him? Right. He's just like a colorful field. We all have a talent, and when we all get together and put it together, it just makes a beautiful design of God. Yeah. And we all work together, a lot of things that we can work together.
And the fingers and the thoughts and the minds went into it, and the Holy Spirit was there at the same time. I feel something like that is going out with something special. Mm-hmm. Something special. No.
I think Rosalie saw a lot of that when she was Rosalie and my name was passing out the mercy mats.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that must have been a tremendous thing. Especially if you have the opportunity to see the world, see the people that really need them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And let them help.
You know? Yeah, it's funny because truly homeless people, because everywhere I work, we have a large
always a group of people back in there, tents, you know, got little huts, that kind of thing. Some of the guys are in the building would go out there and pop a little something, a lean to or something like that, you know, just like a little something to get out of the wood, that kind of thing. So it was a good marriage. They didn't bother the people inside. They didn't bother the people that came, you know, and had to go to the office for one reason or another. So everything worked out good. I came in there one time. Fella came out and wanted to know if he could have some money for some food. I said, well, tell me your situation. Why do you need food? He said, well, I got food to live. I said, well, I know that. I said, I want you to go get some food. He said, I can't. I don't have anything to do with it. So I said, all right. I said, you go to the end of the line and lunch now. I said, I'll go get you lunch. So we went in there and took a ride down the local river, whatever it was. And I told him, I said, no, go ahead and pick out something. He said, there's three other guys back there. He said, is there any chance you might give a little bit extra for them too? I said, as long as you don't go too crazy. He said, I'm not loaded, but I'll help what I can. And on the way back, I go back to it. I said, I just wanted to know Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior of the world. I said, he'll be with you and anybody else that you know, anybody you want to know, for anything that you want to do. I said, that's the only way it's going to happen. I said, you have to stand up. And you have to pray to God to give you the help, the hand that you need to get to it. As long as you're willing to do what he wants you to do. He said, what's that? I said, acknowledge that he's the Lord and accept. But he went back in there and I never saw him again. Matter of fact, the next time I went over there, I guess it was probably 5 months later or something like that, I went over there and they were all cleared out, all the buildings and that kind of thing were all empty. So I don't know. It could have been the police that come by or something like that. Some towns, they won't tolerate it. You know, they don't want you people around here. It's a bad name for the town. If they're homeless, I guess that is a bad name. I'll do something about that. Anyway, let's get back to the story here. Jumping for a better future. MIT's Mimi Cheetah was the first four-legged robot to do a little backflip. Boston Dynamics Atlas robot was the first two-legged humanoid robot to do a more intimidating backflip. Militaristically, it's precision. One website warns us to be very afraid. Robots can now do backflips. Will humanoid robots join us in creating an anticipated better world? Or will they become self-aware and turn on their creators as the Cylons did in the sci-fi movie Battlestar Galactica? I don't know if anybody's ever seen that. Not one that used to be on years ago. Life has been known to imitate art. I've chosen to believe the backflipping robots are jumping for joy. One of my refrigerator magnets shows a humanoid robot jumping, and a custom caption I added says, jump for joy. Robots can for no reason. They can do it. We can do it. The man in scripture who had suffered from birth and miraculously received motor skills that he had never before experienced. Skills that most of us take for granted. His jumping bore witness to his healing and expressed his joy at this new experience. What are we neglecting to praise God for? It's going to happen. Put a lot of confidence in the doctors and that kind of thing. That's good. But this guy has done a talent also. And that talent is healing people. But we have to start. Not saying that we have to put our best foot forward. God will do something for us, whether we do it or not. But if we start, God will do serious, and that's what we need. We need to be sincere about what we ask God. people saw him walking and praising God, and they knew that it was he which said, for yawns at the gate beautiful of the temple, and were filled with wonder and amazement that which had happened unto him. He was jumping for joy, and they knew it, and they knew something was going on. How can believers be attentive to the wonder and amazement of God's miraculous work in the world?
And teaching.
All I can say is don't be like a person that sticks their head in the sand and can't see like a hospital. They get scared and stick their head in the sand. Okay. So don't be like that. You knew what happened? Know where it came from? Pretty good.
And acknowledge it publicly. You know, there's a lot of miracles that still happen, but most people don't believe in miracles anymore. People never talk about that.
Mm-hmm. And that's why Jesus said to the rich man who went to Hades, tell Lazarus to dip his finger in the water and come and let it drip on my tongue. Jesus told him, you had your chance. Mm-hmm. You had your opportunity. Okay. Just because you show some miraculous to the people doesn't mean people are going to miraculously change. Nobody works that way. There's too many people out there on the Lord. They see something miraculous, they see a miracle, it would make any difference. Oh, that was cool, that was great, that's me, let's do it again. Okay? God knows that. God created.
The Bible also tells you to be still and know that I am God. And you can see everything around us that He has done.
Yeah. That's all I have to do. You don't have to say miracles. That's why I have no more miracles. No more publicized miracles like they were back then. There's still miracles.
We had like a miracle
hospital full of them.
Yeah.
Yeah. How would you respond to someone who says that miraculous occurrences can be explained by pagan gods or natural measures?
Everyone's entitled to their opinion, and some are entitled to be wrong.
That's exactly right. That's true. That's very true. And as a lame man, which was healed, helped Peter and John, all the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon's, greatly wondering. Now, the porch outside the altar back in those days was 50 foot wide, and it was between 100 and 150 foot long. So there's a lot of room out there, and that's where a lot of people came to pray, and a lot of people came there to serve because of who was preaching, teaching, or going into the altar once a day, once a month, I think it was, to make an offering to God. Okay. Once a month. And the word often used to describe Jesus' attitude of performing miracles was compassion. The first century church showed compassion for those among them unable to care for themselves. Come on here, buddy. There we go. Peter and John's care for the man in today's text gained the attention of others who were eager to hear Peter's gospel message. The ultimate goal. That's what he was looking for. He knew something like that was going to happen if he went in there and got everybody's attention with this man with the alms. So maybe Peter had a little altar idea going on here when he did that, when he helped the fellow get up on his feet. It gave him an opportunity to preach. Give him an opportunity to share with others Jesus Christ. Involving people with disabilities in service with the church bring surprising results. Find ways for them to serve. If somebody comes in with a wheelchair, they may not realize there's anything that they can do. We can find something for them to do to help serve the church.
Definitely.
Learn new things when a person with disabilities shares from Scripture. List some needs of members of our community. Choose three needs. How can those needs be addressed in our town? That's some of the questions on the handout for today. Okay, I want to take a look at it when we get home. How can our congregation address those needs?
Put ourselves out there, like Jim and doing the nursing home. You know, a lot of people in nursing homes don't have that. But if they do, they don't come around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's sad. It's real sad.
Gary's got that master room he's going to.
Yeah.
Don't remember the name of that.
Yeah, I'm not sure how you're doing, but I'm glad he's.
Well, you know, like Rosalie had a little ministry going, trying to help prisoners that got out that had been incarcerated for a long time because. I'll tell you what, it doesn't matter how much you change in prison. Unless somebody's willing to give you a helping hand when you get out, you're most likely going to end back up in there.
Gary was talking about that one time, you know, the first time I saw him free. Talking about being incarcerated when he's left in the bed. How can you do that? Clarity for how to best meet the perceived needs of people in a community. I'm talking about writing a prayer. The desire to share the gospel with people of the community. And discernment to know how to do both. What they're talking about is when you do talk to somebody, say somebody out of the street, pull the sign out, you want to help that person out. Okay, that kind of thing. Share with them because you never know like that. You never know what it's going to mean for them. Do something brand new, but they need something. And if you're going to help them all the way.
Oh, that would be a surprise to them. It might surprise them all the way.
Yeah. I'm sure a lot of them have heard of
it. I've never done that. I just give them something if I really think they need it.
What I used to do, Troy, one time, especially on the truck, when somebody came up to me for help, or you know, came up to me for food, whatever, like that, I would put a dollar bill inside a gospel tract, an animal tract.
You do what?
Put a dollar bill inside. They see the money. Okay, I handle that. Now, I don't know how long I'm going to hang on the track if they're going to read it, but they got it in their hand. That was my.
And if they throw it down, somebody else will pick it up.
That's true. I've seen people reaching out and picking them up.
Yeah. All about about the bills, I think now, they're a little bit high.
Yeah.
$10. I can give them $50 or maybe $20.
Yeah, but that's, I don't know if I could hand out $100. Offer spiritual healing as you meet physical needs, as you meet other people. Go with speed is all I can say. Go with the Spirit. Right. A lot of times I come up to somebody like a family that used to stand on the corner down here on Eugene and from Walmart town. It was a family. Had a husband, a wife, had kids, a couple of dogs. And go by and just let them know. Jesus Christ will make a difference in your life. Camera track, you give them a couple of bucks. I'll never give a lot of money to my ex. I want to give a lot of money to my brother or something like that. They don't need a lot of money. All right. But the main thing is when you do something like that, you're not sure whether they are, whether they aren't, whether they need it, whether they don't. Let the Holy Spirit guide you. Let the Holy Spirit guide you. You'll know inside if you should or you should not give something like that, like money.
then we called the pastor when we were in church that time. And he gave the church gave enough money to put him up in a hotel for a couple of months. And I told Eric, I said, you know, there's four kids, two men and a man and his wife, one man and two dogs, and there are two pit bulls. And it was a little bitty RV. I looked at Eric and I said, you know, I said, I don't know if you need to be doing all this. And he's like, why? I said, Eric, all them, and a couple of them kids were teenagers. They weren't small. I said, look at the windows in that RV. It was just nasty. I thought, that many people living in there, you can't live in someplace that small and not have no organization. Well, I mean, Eric went out above and beyond board. His mother had died. He had that place down there where he's living now. Spent $2,000 putting on his credit card, getting cattle, getting that place livable for them. Put them down in there. Give the husband a job. Start taking them to church. Church welcomed men, one of the men in church, give every member of that family a brand new Bible. Church where I work, we gathered clothes, took them bags of clothes. Well, Eric couldn't get him half work. And one day he went over there and they were gone. And that house was that deep in all the nice clothes that people had given. They had walked on, trash on, food on. They had their dogs in there and they had litter puppies on them. They had to shovel that place out and get it clean. And, you know, I told Eric, I said, it's nothing wrong with helping anybody. But when you first offer somebody stuff and then they don't try to, they don't help them help. Yeah, they don't start doing anything for themselves. I'm like, there's a time to stop. And sure did. But that didn't deter me. There's people I still help. But I'm a little bit more discerning about who I help now.
But they had little kids, too.
Well, and the one thing about it, Troy, now most of them left in Bibles there. They didn't take them with them. Yeah. They wrote their names in my suit. In fact, the one I use today is one of them Bibles. And but there was one child, and she didn't want to go to them. She begged us to adopt her. And I thought, out of all that'll come, if that one child has learned something from going to church and getting a Bible, because her Bible wasn't weak,
right,
it'll be all worth it.
Well, that little kid didn't have anything to do with it. It's a good punishment.
And like
you said, you never know what is going to make the difference.
You plant a seed somewhere.
Yeah, that's right. Definitely.
Yes. And you never know.